it, boys.
This is it. This is the queen, the terrible. We're not going to call it Bohemian Rhapsody because whenever I've wanted to tweet about it and say, I hate Bohemian Rhapsody, can't stop thinking about how much I hate Bohemian Rhapsody. I don't want anyone to be confused. That's the greatest recording ever. Love that song. Beautiful. Great stuff. The Terrible Queen movie was terrible, and we've got the people to prove it. Jeff is in town. Ugh. Pete Blackburn. My name's Brave Dave. Speaks for everybody.
Yeah.
I like how this worked out because before we even saw the movie, we came up with the idea. We said we should have Jeff on.
We want a Jeff episode.
We're overdue for a Jeff episode. Saw the movie. Mm. I got wicked excited that Jeff was coming on for this because this is going to be a doozy of a discussion.
Okay, go ahead.
Oh no. You're right. I had low expectations and it didn't meet them.
Okay, so we are all going to go around and basically give opening thoughts of sorts. Jeff, you are the guest. I will go first. Bohemian Rhapsody tells the story of how the most innovative band this side of the Beatles won over the world for two decades, while the greatest frontman to ever live did drugs and had all the gay sex to his heart's content until it literally killed him. It was a story so incredible and so true that all they had to do was tell it for it to be the epic that it was. Oh, wait. Bohemian Rhapsody tells the story of Rami Malek dressed as a horse while he and his bandmates go head-to-head with a studio executive who never existed over a battle that never existed. In it, Freddie Mercury forces one of the best singing drummers of all time to sing the high notes that he sang before Freddie was even in the band, as the band enjoys an illustrious career of recording two albums, to the dismay of a very convincing Brian May lookalike and a surprisingly esteemed John Deacon. Freddie breaks up the band so he can record a solo album and possibly get AIDS from doing cocaine during the years while Queen recorded one of its more popular albums featuring two of its biggest hits in Radio Gaga and I Want to Break Free. Then, 2 years before Freddie Mercury was diagnosed with AIDS, he and the band decide to reunite and do a big concert for Freddie that they let the rest of the world call Live Aid. It features plenty of never-before-heard Queen factoids made up of entirely never-before-happened Queen factoids. You want to miss it.
That's a good review.
That is an unbelievable review. Like, you should write for
I wrote it in Panera, like, 5 minutes ago.
That's unbelievable. I'm mad that you went first now.
Yeah, I know. Now mine's going to stink.
Go ahead, Jeff.
I guess, basically, what I wanted to say is that going into this movie, like, I didn't know much about Queen other than their music, mm-hmm. and afterwards, I still don't know much
exactly
about Queen.
Yes, that is such a good point.
And it was just like a paint by numbers. They made shit up. Essentially, the end is all of Live Aid, the 20 minutes of Live Aid. That shit is on YouTube. Just watch it on YouTube. Save money. Just watch the fucking YouTube.
And it's so much literally better when they do it. Like, real John Deacon is there. And
exactly.
Freddie Mercury and all those guys.
Exactly. I don't understand why anyone would pay to see this movie when the best part of it, the real thing, is on YouTube.
Yes. And everybody said, well, you have to admit, the music was great. That's because the music they used
Queen.
Was just Queen.
Yeah.
So the only thing that the snowman was missing was a Queen soundtrack?
That would have been interesting.
It's, do that. We should fix bad movies by adding Queen.
Well, Jeff made
this
the point
unbelievable
that the best movie that's been made this year with Queen music is Game Night.
Game Night.
And the best Lucy Boynton band movie was Sing Street.
Yes.
That and was the best the movie to feature Bohemian Rhapsody was Wayne's World.
Yes.
I guess I tweeted immediately after the fact. I was like, that movie, I enjoyed the Live Aid scene just because it was so big, and I think that was like a perfect place to finish. I don't think you can really finish anywhere else if you're making a Queen movie.
Well, you could have finished it actually when he was diagnosed
right,
with AIDS.
Right, exactly. Yeah. Like, that's a big issue that we'll get to later, but yeah. I thought that was a cool finish to the movie. The previous 2 hours was completely useless, and I think the best word that I could describe it is it was soulless. Like,
yes.
That was such a soulless movie. And, like, I guess my biggest issue is that I didn't, like Jeff said, I didn't learn anything about Queen. And if you're not going to tell the story and you're going to do a paint-by-numbers biopic, then at least do it correctly and right. tell the story correctly.
Right, yeah.
And make it, not even make it believable, like, make it believable because it's what actually fucking happened.
Right, like, I remember this before, you said, I think it's just going to give us Wikipedia. I so would have taken Wikipedia right. because it's way more interesting.
Yeah, to go after and read it and be like, oh, like that's actually what happened?
Right, like, do you know yeah. how he met John Hutton, his partner?
The guy that looked like Rob Delaney, and I kept thinking was Rob yeah. Delaney the entire movie.
So in real life, he met John Hutton at a club, and it was like a gay club, and John Hutton was a hairdresser. And he had, I think he was with somebody at the time, but it was like a little bit of a like Wolf of Wall Street kind of thing where gotcha. they fudge the timeline a little bit and they get together. In this movie, instead, they make John Hutton a caterer yeah. who Freddie sexually assaults while on the job. And then they have a heart-to-heart, and then Freddie stalks him for 2.5 years, and then they get together. None of that happened. They met in a club. They went in a gay club, which is where gay people go. They did a lot of things that gay people do that are not portrayed in this movie. This movie, I saw tweets. Somebody said, I learned from watching Bohemian Rhapsody that you contract AIDS by looking at somebody from a yes. from a payphone.
Yes. Yeah.
And he sees Adam Lambert, gives him a little look, and then bam.
Wait, was that Adam Lambert?
So, I think.
Oh, my God.
And I the first time that I cringed in this, well, I guess it probably wasn't the first time that I cringed in this movie, but one of the biggest cringes that I got in this movie was like the first reference to him maybe being gay is him staring at a rest stop trucker yes. going into a bathroom.
So I think what they're trying to say there is that like he's meeting that guy. And they're kind of giving each other the eyes.
Right, but that's yeah. the first time that like they reference him being
oh,
gay.
Oh, right, yeah. And that's like after the band has recorded,
like they're
I guess,
tour.
One-third of album. And yeah. they're on tour. After recording their first album in this movie, they tell them, we need... By the way, Queen is like the best, most innovative studio band, right? Like they did... Their albums, obviously, are just incredible sounding, and there's stuff on that on those albums that still aren't on anything else because they just labored and labored and labored. They showed them in the studio for like a total of 4 minutes in this movie,
yep.
and here's what they show. They show them swinging an amplifier as if to say, we do crazy stuff in the studio. They show Roger Taylor doing a million different passes of the Galileo part against his will. He does not want to be singing this song that they all wanted to be singing, and they all totally loved, and everybody loved that Mike Myers guy, the Ray Foster character, not a person, did not exist. There was no pushback. They were like, yo, the song's a little long, but... that the DJ, Freddie's friend, yep. was already playing it on the radio, so it was this huge thing. It needed no help. There was no fight, and people in the theater, the stupid olds, where they were like clapping yeah. every time they would stick it to the like, exec that didn't want them to play their rock and roll.
And their studio scene, their studio montage, if you want to call it a montage, like it was just them doing goofy shit. Like I'm pretty sure there was a lampshade on somebody's head at one point.
Oh yeah,
and it was just like. It was like, and the like the big crux of that was that like somebody walked into the studio and was like, oh, these guys are fucking wacky. Let's sign them to a deal.
And this is when they're recording their first album. They say, let's get into the studio and let's record an album. And so that would have been the album Queen, which their first two albums were just like rock albums. It wasn't until Sheer Heart Attack, the one that has Killer Queen on it, that they really started to get what would be called like Baroque or whatever. But in this movie, they go in, they record one album, then they go on tour for 11 years off of one album, and the studio calls them in. They say, they love, that. We need you guys to make another album. Theoretically, in this movie, I guess, a second album. Yeah. And they want more stuff like Killer Queen, which is going to be on your third album. So they say, okay, let's make a second album called A Night at the Opera. Whoa, it's 1975 already? Let's do it. And they go into the studio, and their time in the studio of recording, again, just the most creative, crazy stuff. That album, like Seaside Rendezvous, Roger Taylor was playing. He was putting thimbles on his fingers to record like tap dancing sounds. They were feeding stuff to headphones and putting them in cans and then miking the cans so it would sound like all this crazy stuff. They were just doing ridiculous stuff. They showed in this movie They gave John Deacon a small room when they were sleeping. That was the night of the opera experience that was shown.
Yeah, it was ridiculous.
No mention of Roy Thomas Baker or Reinhold Mack, who were both, and that's like that might be a nitpicky complaint that I understand. You don't need to show like the producers and the other people that were making it, but like, if you're not telling a story of Queen making crazy ass music, what are you telling?
Well, exactly.
Because they weren't telling a Freddie Mercury story.
Well, let me cut in here. Like, I'm fine if you wanna like leave other things out.
Fudge it.
And yeah, and like if you want to sacrifice certain areas, but the fact that they had so many things, so many parts of the story to tell that would have been so interesting to see in depth, and they didn't do any of them right. Or didn't do any of them justice.
What
is so frustrating.
We didn't get the cool Queen stuff. And
you didn't get the
music. Implore all the listeners, go look up any of the videos of, there's documentary stuff on those albums where they talk about what they did, and it's so interesting. But yeah, you didn't get the music.
Didn't get the music. You didn't get, like, his life, really.
No.
They completely glossed over, like, the fact that he changed his name, his upbringing, and stuff. Like, you didn't... They referenced that, and there was, like, scenes of it, but there's no explanation. You have no idea why he was motivated to do the things that he did in terms of, like, how he grew up, why he wanted to change his name, why he was, like, so sort of introverted as far as, like, his own personality and not his stage persona. Like, you didn't get any of that. You didn't really get, like, the band's true story.
No.
You didn't get, like, the AIDS... scenario and how they dealt with that. They did nothing well.
Here's a question I ask. What would you say Freddie's personality was based on that movie?
Honestly, and this was like, made me feel bad, like he almost seemed kind of dumb and just did whatever anyone
was... That movie
was...
didn't paint him in a good light.
No, I don't think so either. And yeah.
And he was known as being like this very, very sweet man.
Yeah.
Like he was out of his mind, like drugs, and when he would get on the stage, he would do all this crazy stuff. And that the thing with Paul Prenter, their manager turned lover.
Yeah.
Like that thing was true that he said that like Freddie would have a different lover every night. So he certainly lived a rock and roll lifestyle. But like, if you watch interviews with him, he was this like very thoughtful man. In this, and this is where I get on Rami Malek, because he's partially to blame here too. He was only the oh well, hello, darling, Freddie. That's
right.
All he ever was. There was never he did not emote at all. No emotion.
I put that on him though. Like I want to have a discussion about like how we felt about Rami Malek in this, because we had different takeaways. I thought that he was good, and I thought that of all the problems that I had with this movie, he's very far down the list. And I think that what you're talking about and your criticisms here has a lot more to do with the writing and the directing than it does with Rami Malek.
Kind of like I was rooting for him, and when I figured it was going to be a bad movie, I was like, well, at least I'll get to watch Freddie Mercury for a couple hours.
It's hard to put depth into a character when there's no depth in the movie.
Right. That's fair. Like I guess like all the scenes where you would think he would be like big and grand, he just wasn't. He was just, it's almost like he took lessons on how to do the five different Freddies. And he got one of them down, and they were like, oh, all right, whatever. No one's going to see this anyway. Just just do that the whole time.
Didn't it make like $50 million this weekend?
Yeah,
it
did. Crushed.
And we should definitely talk about the reception to it, because it's all over the place.
Yeah.
I mean, it's so right now I have the ratings pulled up, and I've seen glowing reviews. I've seen people who have agreed with us and that they were frustrated and that did nothing for them. Right now on IMDb, it's 8.4 out of 10.
Holy shit!
I know. Rotten Tomatoes is a 60% out of 60% out of 100, and Metacritic is 50% out of 100, and then Google users, 98% of Google users like this.
So So you said Rotten Tomatoes gives it a 60.
Yes.
The audience score on Rotten Tomatoes
is
95.
Yeah.
What?
So people just answering the question, did you like it or not, are resoundingly like 9.5 out of 10 people are saying, yes, I liked it.
That's crazy. I think what people are taking away is that like, oh, it's a cool excuse to listen to Queen
right.
super, super loud on a thing.
Yeah.
And that was kind of cool. However, this movie is fucking interminably long. It was like 2.5 hours
yes.
long.
Yes.
And everything in between those musical montages was crap. Boring yeah. and yeah. shitty and very just like bland. I think, Pete, like you were talking about it earlier, this story, like Freddie Mercury is a immigrant baggage handler at Heathrow Airport, and then he became Freddie Mercury.
Yeah.
How did that happen?
Yes.
There's you no, there's you do not nothing. Know. The first 10 minutes, like, was like, if they took 2.5 hours on the first 10 minutes of like, here's this dude, he rebels against his family, he joins Queen, they start an album. That was like 10 minutes long, and after that, they had a record deal and were touring the U.S., right. and then nothing else happened.
Literally the first, like, 20 minutes of the movie, he's a baggage handler. Then that night, he decides he's going to go out that night. He goes to a bar. He sees what will become Queen play.
Smile.
Their singer quits. He meets him in the parking lot. Boom, you've got Queen.
Well, you forgot to. He also met his fiance on the walkthrough to meet the band. So, yeah. like, everything yeah. was handled.
His entire life yeah. was one walk. In 30 minutes.
Drank a beer, went backstage, met his wife, and joined a band.
There, you guys missed one this. Walk. There was also a stand selling cats on his way back there.
yeah, yeah, yeah.
So he was able to pick up his lot cats
of fucking,
as well.
Lot of cats. Fucking cutaway shots to his cats.
Only thing they yes. got right in this movie was the Freddie Mercury liked cats. Yeah. Like, really, that's what you are going to do? You're going to gloss over the whole gay thing, but, like, you got to know. Yeah, you please do not come away from this movie thinking he's a dog guy. He loved cats.
He loved cats, yeah. The AIDS thing was crazy. I don't know if we can jump to it, but like
yeah.
it's obviously one of the biggest things to ever happen in music and, and to Freddie Mercury specifically.
Yeah.
If you went to the bathroom,
I would say that it was a pretty
yeah.
big,
if
pretty
you went
big
to
thing.
The bathroom and you came back and the title cards ended, it said Freddie Mercury died of AIDS, you'd be like, he had AIDS? Like, that's yeah. how quick it was. Yes. It was 30 seconds.
And
like, boom.
Let us not gloss over the fact that the one scene that they address the AIDS in is yeah. maybe the worst scene of the
oh
year.
Oh, my God.
I had forgot. I blacked it out of my mind. And then so Ryan Lambert bad. Saw it and tweeted about that. And I was like, oh, my God.
Just the hallway when
I
he's
think
just
I
like,
I think we started A-O. Texting each other about that. We're like, oh, my God, the AO scene.
Yes.
Oh, my God.
Yeah, so they there's the scene where he finally goes to the doctor and finds out that he has, is it HIV or is it AIDS? I'm not sure. I don't
well, the
think
cool thing was it was 3 years before he had AIDS, so the doctor said, hey, we got out ahead of this early, so yeah. just don't get AIDS over the next couple of years, and we can beat this.
I know, and what was the point of that? What was the point of messing up that
the point
of
this was, I think that Live Aid paid for the movie or something. Did any of that money actually go to the families there, or did they just save it for years God. To then pay for this movie? Because they made, the movie begins and ends with Live Aid, yeah. which obviously that was a great performance. Live Queen's set at Live Aid was like 22 minutes, just yeah. like everybody else. Like, yeah. like you don't see is the Phil Collins movie all going to be about the time that he came?
But they
out
did.
And,
but like the Queen set at Live Aid
was epic.
Like, yeah,
like
yeah.
everything else though, because it was, it's just one of the, I don't know, 5 or 10 good high quality recordings of Queen live. But it's not like. So he gets that little diagnosis, and we can hit on this now. So he's told, you have AIDS. He's walking out. There's a kid sitting off to the side, also has AIDS, and he thinks he recognizes Freddie, and he goes, Ayo? And Freddie says,
very, very somberly,
yes,
Ayo.
It is the worst.
It's so bad.
And the kid's like, so darn, bad. He must have AIDS. Oh, man.
It was like a after-school special.
Like, people with AIDS like have this like language that they speak or something. That's how like, homophobic know, this movie was.
You know how like you ever hear the story about like people who drive Jeep Wranglers, when they pass another Jeep Wrangler on the
yeah.
road, they like throw up like the horns yeah. or something? That was basically
AIDS
what this
telepathy.
Scene was.
Yeah. They had AIDS telepathy. So then Freddie finds out that Live Aid is happening. Now, he would know about Live Aid, but Live Aid has been asking Queen to play, and they keep calling his manager and saying, hey, isn't Queen going to play Live Aid? But he doesn't tell them. No, Queen wasn't invited to do Live Aid because they had done, I forget what they did, but it was because of Queen. Queen
no,
did something that pissed people off.
I know the actual story, and it's way more interesting than what happened in the movie.
Right. Didn't they played it like a...
So what happened was Bob Geldof announced the lineup of Live Aid and announced that Queen was playing before asking anybody. So they were pissed, and they wanted to play, and then Bob Geldof put his band immediately after Queen. So to upstage him, they originally only had 15 minutes to play.
Yeah.
And they played for like 25 minutes, destroyed everything, and then Bob Geldof and his fucking band that no one's ever heard of had to go back out and follow that, and that was their like, fuck you to
That's him. Amazing. That's awesome. I also know that there was like it was almost like people were boycotting Troye Sivan's concert because Kim Petras was opening and she works with Dr. Luke. It was like this was like a very 2018 thing to happen back in 1985. But Queen had played at some show where they'd played in a country where something bad was going on. And
Got
you
it.
Ask, but DJ. How did they? What do you mean they played? They were broken up because Freddie broke up the band.
Oh yeah,
the
classic Queen breakup.
Yeah, we all remember when Queen broke up in the '80s,
and Freddie went to Munich.
And I Want to Break Free. Well, he went to Munich to record his album, but the album came out a million years later, and it was during this time, like I said, that Queen made the album The Works, which had I Want to Break Free and Radio Gaga. They played Live Aid like 2 months after finishing a world tour, so. They make this whole thing, and again, Freddie does not have AIDS yet. He says to the band, you know what, let's reunite, and we'll play Live Aid. And they make him stand outside and sweat it out while they decide whether this guy who does not have AIDS gets to play this show with them. And they say, okay, fine, we'll play the show. And as they're rehearsing, Freddie has to keep taking breaks because his AIDS is acting up. Yep. Does not have AIDS. And at the end of the rehearsal, he says to the guys, as though he's had a great idea, guys, I've got it. And Roger Taylor says, got what, Freddie? And he says, AIDS. And they say, okay, well, we'll play the show for Freddie. And then they play Live Aid. None of that happened.
And here's where they sort of use their attempted get-out-of-jail-free card in the movie, where they try to explain why they didn't cover the AIDS as well as they should have. They had Freddie go... I don't want it to be about the AIDS. I don't want to be the spokesperson for AIDS. Let's not focus on the AIDS. Let's focus on the music. And that was definitely their get out of jail free card as far as like, why didn't you cover the AIDS in depth? And they'd be like, well, watch that scene. Freddie wouldn't want this movie to be about his AIDS.
Freddie was a pretty big AIDS figurehead, being that he was Freddie Mercury and that he got AIDS. Yeah.
And the AIDS... pretty big part of the Freddie Mercury story.
Yeah, you know.
So
what?
You fucking should tell the part of that story.
Yeah, it could have been a nice time for like education and raising awareness and like, okay, this is. I saw this movie at Legacy Place, and I got a new phone afterwards, and I got the iPhone product Red, which like things go to HIV AIDS research, like a portion of the proceeds.
Nice.
I did more immediately after. watching this movie than all of Bohemian Rhapsody has done for the movement.
Yeah.
That is very true. Let's hit a quick sponsor. You probably already know what The Athletic is if you're a sports fan. It's a place where literally all your favorite writers probably right now. They're scooping up talent left and right. Guys like Ken Rosenthal, Jason Stark, Zach Harper for the NBA, Sam Amick, Frank Isola, Pierre LeBrun, Jay Glazer. Pretty much every big name now writes for The Athletic. So if you're a sports fan, there's a good chance you're subscribed. But if you're not, we have a great deal. It's 40% off, $2.99 a month. If you're not totally sure what The Athletic is, it's a subscription-based publisher of smarter sports coverage for diehard fans. The model is simple. No ads, no pop-ups, no autoplay videos. They're all about the content. They're all about the stories. Readers subscribe for an authentic, in-depth coverage written by journalists who know the teams inside and out. That coverage goes beyond game recaps and trade speculation, and they provide smarter analysis and deeper perspective about teams and leagues, whether it's MLB, NBA, NFL, NHL, all across the board. If you subscribe, you get access to local and national content. Which is, it comes out to about 600 to 700 news stories per week across all sports. So if you go to theathletic.com/brunch, you'll be able to subscribe for 40% off. That's $2.99 a month. It's an insane deal for the quality product that they're sharing for sports fans. It is a great publisher. You can subscribe and be a part of the future of sports journalism. So that's theathletic.com/brunch for a $2.99 per month subscription. Highly recommend it. I read them all the time.
Let's hit on some particularly terrible moments, ones that made us mad. I don't know if I should. I'll just get to it. The Mike Myers thing was obviously dreadful.
Fuck.
Again, Mike Myers plays a studio executive who looks like exactly like Jeff Lynne for some reason. Like a slightly fatter, way sweatier Jeff Lynne. He's basically a combination of Jeff Lynne and Frank from Scarface.
Yeah.
You know, like, you a Haza Frank. That guy. And he keeps telling them, no, you can't do this. You can't do this. And he listens to opera in his office. And that's why Freddie wrote Bohemian Rhapsody.
He looks like a dude that would get murdered in, like, one of the first three seasons of The Sopranos.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So this was when I realized that I was angry and hating the movie. When they bring in Bohemian Rhapsody to him, and he says, no, this won't be a hit. He says,
what about I'm in love with my car?
You're joking.
Oh, jeez. Love it. Well, that's the kind of song teenagers can crank up the volume in their car and bang their heads to. Bohemian Rhapsody will never be that song.
And then Pete turned to me and said, did you get that reference? And I almost killed everyone.
Me being like, did you get it?
Right. And I was like,
I have that down in my notes. I was like, that is the exact moment that I could tell that DJ fucking hated this movie.
Yeah.
I turned to him in like a mocking tone. I was like, hey, did you get it? And he's like, yes.
So yes, Pete, I got it. And like 16 seconds later, you hear all the old people like,
Wayne's World. So I had a delayed reaction. I got the reference and I was like, oh, Wayne's World, fuck. And then I remembered seeing Mike Myers in the credits. And then like 5 minutes later when they're recording, I was just like, oh, fuck, that was Mike Myers? No.
Yeah, it is. It's very Tom Cruise in, what's it called?
Tropic Thunder.
Yeah, Thunder.
And so... It made me 10 times more mad when I went home and I saw like a couple days ago that Mike Myers was doing the talk show circuit, and I think that he was with Colbert, and they play the Wayne's World clip and that clip of the movie back to back, and he's just like going on waxing poetic about like how his life has come full circle, and like I'm just like, shut the fuck up, this is the worst. You put this scene in the movie just so that you could fucking do this.
Exactly. Yeah. That was the most like self-flagellating. Because again, that didn't exist. That wasn't a thing that happened. There was never a sit-down where a guy was like, no, we won't do it. And they throw a rock through his window afterwards. And then he turns around and they've all changed into leather jackets and they're snapping like this. And they're like, don't mess with us, execy. And
it just pissed me off because I don't think the movie like earned that joke. Like none there were like maybe four jokes in the whole movie, and it was like a joyless film, like a joyless experience. And like, I don't know, they made Brian and Roger like not really have personalities.
That was the
and
weirdest thing.
Also, they didn't fucking age. That drove me fucking crazy.
Oh, yeah.
They met in college and then like they have wives, and then they're like, we're too old to tour.
At one point when Roger, Freddie asks Roger to stay for dinner, he goes, I can't. It's 1980. Kids. It's become 1984, you see. And now I have a wife and kids. And Freddie said, ah, yes, this is where
we are.
Didn't
you notice,
Freddie?
I changed my hair.
Right.
I have kids now.
Yeah.
So I was very surprised with how they portrayed Roger. They made Roger like a nothing. And Roger was this awesome rock star who wrote these great songs and obviously a great singer and did all this cool stuff. Brian was the genius of the group and the smart one. But they didn't give him a personality. And given that he's the one that was the driving force behind what made so much of this bad, I thought at least they would make the Brian May character cool. They did. He did look and sound.
He looked just
exactly like him. I found it very interesting how much attention they played to John Deacon, because the easiest thing to do in this movie is John Deacon was the quiet bass player who wrote a lot of hit songs, but when he would bring them in, that he would just like kind of like throw them at them and be like, I don't know if this is any good. Just do the song if you want. And it would be like, You're My Best Friend. Or it would be like Another One Bites the Dust or something. And once Freddie died, he just went away, and no one's heard from him. He's like,
really?
Yeah, he was just this very like seemingly didn't want to be in the spotlight kind of guy. And they played. I liked that they shined such a light on his contributions to the band. But they would make him all chatty and talkative. They
had
him
played by the kid. That's the one thing that you could ignore.
Right, exactly. Yeah. That was the easy thing. And they had him played by the kid from Jurassic Park, which I didn't know. That's little kid from Jurassic Park.
Really?
And it was driving me crazy. I was like, who is this guy?
There were a lot of names in this movie that didn't get like good roles. Like Littlefinger, Carcetti, yes, Aidan Gillen. Yeah. Like, he was just sort of there.
He was
Tom
just like,
Hollander.
We need a British guy.
Yeah, Miami.
Oh, right. Yeah. Oh, I forgot about that.
Yeah, he was just sort of there. Miami, Tom Hollander. Mm-hmm. I don't know if you guys have seen The Night Manager, but he's in that. That they just like all these like cool guys, like even Lucy Boynton was just sort of like there to be like a thing.
They've
like,
got to stop. They're starting to Vergara Lucy Boynton, which is Vergara is they're like, hey, come in this and be beautiful and clumsy. And like Chef is the only thing that lets her just be like, hey,
the actual term for that is typecasting.
Right. Yeah. Lucy Boynton, other than Sing Street, is like, hey, we're just going to have the camera on you and do whatever you want. Just have that pretty face of yours. Yeah. And that's all that she did in this movie, except for she told off Freddie in telling him that he was gay.
Yes,
and then she backtracked and realized, like, oh, wait, this is 2018. She was like, you're gay, Freddie. And then she goes over to the window and she's like, I mean, It's just that this has impacted this marriage is all, and I'm not mad at you.
I like that they approached the coming out scene with her telling Freddie what he is.
Yeah, because he goes, I'm bisexual, and she goes, no. You're gay.
Yeah. Like, oh, honey. Another big cringe, angry part of the movie came in that scene. That scene starts with him sitting her down, and he shows a video of them playing Love of My Life. And the whole audience is singing along. And it's like, it was so crazy that they were singing along because we didn't know that they knew the words to any of our songs. And after all, this is just, A, you're queen. And B, do you know why people sang along at Queen concerts? Because Freddie Mercury was notorious for doing only two things. Rocking way too hard, so he was going to have to take a little break. And then conducting people for the other songs. And look up any video of Queen playing Love of My Life. And that's what it is. He sits with Brian. Brian plays the intro and everything. And then he conducts them. They sing it. And then he goes, you're beautiful. And I can't do a Freddie voice or whatever. But that's what it was. And that leads to her being like, oh, speaking of which, you're gay, huh? And I was like, oh, all of this scene.
If we're talking about stuff that made me cringe, we should definitely hit on, and I don't know if this happened in every single theater, but before they actually showed the movie, there was like this weird sort of PSA thing of like Rami Malek addressing the crowd, the movie theater crowd, and was like, hey, thank you so much for coming to see this movie.
Ayo, it's me, Rami Malek.
I don't have AIDS. Not yet. But he would like address the movie theater crowd and was like, thank you so much for coming out to this movie. It's like, you made this possible. And it was like, that was the moment where I knew that it was going to be a bad movie.
Agreed.
Because I was like, why did they put this here?
Right, he's like,
what are they buttering me
up
for?
He's like, I get it. You shouldn't be here. Yeah. You're like, I shouldn't?
Yeah.
Speaking of the intro, I knew I hated it when the
20th Century Fox
the
guitar.
The 20th Century Fox guitar. But not just any guitar. They did it like all Brian May-like, except they didn't do it on a guitar. They did it on a $20 Radio Shack keyboard on the distorted electric guitar setting, and it went, ga-ga-da-ga. No guitar goes, ga. And it's going, ga-ga-da-ga, ga-ga-ga-ga-ga-ga. And
it's
I hate this movie.
He made this movie. Like, just have him record the
ask
thing.
Ask him to do it. Ask Brian May to do it. You've got access to him.
I normally like when movies do that. Like Scott Pilgrim does that in like 8-bit.
I watched
Happy Death Day does it the best way.
I watched Scott Pilgrim for the first time 2 days ago.
Oh, what'd you think?
Yes, I thought it was pretty good.
Super fun movie.
Yeah, it's super fun.
Yeah. Very weird. Very, I was like, okay, I have to just be here for this.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
So go in there.
I liked it, yeah.
I like when there's a Funny Onion article that's like Warner Brothers logos gets all distorted.
Yeah,
guy expecting shit to be fucked up, like, you know, like something like that.
Happy Death Day has a cool one. It goes, ooh.
too spooky for me.
And then it starts over, and then it does it, and it does it like a few different times.
Oh,
and you're like, wait a second.
Is that an Easter egg?
Am I reliving the same 20th century Fox
it's
thing?
Like, and then it's like, nope, I just came to see this movie for the second time in a row because I'm DJ B.
I went 2 days in a row. I considered going to see this again because I was like, I really need to have my thoughts collected.
I can't. I'm never going to watch it.
It's so burned in that I had enough. I didn't have to read really anything about it. Because I wanted it to be fresh in all my anger. The only thing I read was Ryan Lambert's tweet about the AODES diagnosis. And
oh, I thought you were talking about Happy Death Day still, and I was like, what?
No. Oh, I've written and read plenty about Happy Death Day.
Speaking of Lambert, I feel like we should talk about why people like this movie. Because he had a pretty... He made a good point about why people are enjoying this
movie. As only he could.
Because it's just like, it's people gobbling up nostalgia shit, no matter how fucking... how good... like, it's people who can't think critically and are just like, oh, Queen, nice.
Right.
And that's sort of like the Greta Van Fleet.
Exactly. It's the same thing as Greta Van Fleet. They think that by saying they don't like this movie, they're saying that they don't like Queen. And they're like, they played Queen. What kind of fan are you if you don't like it? It sounds just like
people who came into the theater that were going to say that they love the movie no matter what.
Yeah.
Right. And I was going back and forth with some people on Twitter. Why do I do it? And someone was like, well, Brian May was an executive producer. It couldn't be that far off. And I was like,
look at the timeline. Yeah.
I was like, everything went wrong because of that guy.
That's actually when I knew it was fucked up, when I saw their names in the credits. And I think I had known that. And I hated Straight Outta Compton, and that got kind of like...
I do want to talk about that, but go ahead.
But like, once I saw their heavy involvement, I was like, oh boy, and I know we might talk about Sacha Baron Cohen a little bit later, but I guess he was the one that like got rid of Sacha Baron Cohen because he didn't want it to be all about Freddie Mercury.
I think he said like it's not just going to be like drugs and gay stuff the whole movie. And
would have 100,000% preferred drugs and gay stuff all for 2 hours.
Well, he was like, so like, what's this going to be about?
Right.
Like, yeah, and so it ended up being sort of about Freddie Mercury, but not really about Queen, and not really about... So this movie was about nothing.
It suffers from the theory of everything.
Say it was about... You can't really say that it was about Queen. You can't really say that it was about Freddie Mercury. You can't really say that it was about anything. It was just like a hybrid.
Want to do a rankings of what this movie was about?
Yeah,
all right, number one, Live Aid.
Yeah.
Number one, Live Aid. Number two, Cats. Number three, The life and times of Ray Foster, of sweaty Jeff Lynne, non-existent man Ray Foster.
This movie was not about partying. Can we talk about the party? The epic party scenes?
No wonder they left the party. They were like, yo, this party's whack.
Yeah.
They were like,
this party's too crazy for me, Freddie. We have kids. We got to go home. I was like, I would have left that party at like my age.
Yeah, the only time in this movie that it was like assumed that, or like even got close to Freddie Mercury having sex, was when his party was so lame that everybody left at like 9 p.m.
Yeah.
And the only guy left in his house was a caterer.
It was
that
a
he
caterer
sexually
that
harassed.
He is sexually assaulted.
Yeah, sexually assaulted. Well, they do two things. One, when they're in the limo. These are the two instances drugs are shown. One, at the raging party, they like show a coffee table.
Yes,
and there's just like...
A little coke.
There's like... so little, like, it could just be, like, a dusty table. And then in the limo, Peter Prentice, is that his name?
Peter Prenter.
Peter Prenter. Yeah. He gives
Paul Prenter?
Paul. He gives Freddie a pill, which he takes with a drink, and then immediately, like, he fires Aidan Gillen, and Aidan Gillen's like, you're high, Freddie. And it's like, it's like Saved by the Bell. Like,
yeah.
Like, it's, like, immediately you're high after doing that. It was insane. Yeah.
It's that pot you're on. When Mary goes to visit him in Munich,
right, there's a lot of drugs on the table.
There's a little drugs on the table, and then Paul shows up as Leather Daddy.
Yeah, Leather Daddy from Tobias Fuque.
Yes, something that says Daddy likes leather.
And also, apparently, did he walk home to England? How did he get home? He just started walking
in the rain.
He's like,
one,
I'm
there was a
here.
Cab.
This party
like,
sucks.
She called an Uber like somehow in the 70s, and there was a cab waiting for her, and he just walked to England from Germany.
And it was another. It was one of those classic "quit standing in the rain" moments where Freddy's outside, and he's like, "Paul, I want you gone," and Paul's like, "It's it's raining really loudly. Can you just come closer to the house and speak to me?
It's raining really loudly, and the timeline's very cloudy. I'm not really sure if you have AIDS yet. Yeah. If you do, you probably shouldn't be in the rain because your
immune system isn't so good.
You're already playing with fire.
The timeline's...
Also, we're wearing an awful lot of leather. We shouldn't be,
we can't be outside. The timeline's so cloudy, it's starting to rain.
Yes.
But I just, ever like watch a movie and it's raining out, and you just like feel bad for the act. Like, it just takes you out of the movie, and I'm like, this looked like it was fucking miserable. Like,
yeah,
Bryan Singer probably like just got fired and they're like, all right, cool, you got a 6-hour shoot in the rain, we got to shoot it on both ways, full coverage.
How do you think morale was?
Morale was probably terrible.
Like, right? Or were the people that were there at the end, did they feel like they got what they wanted? You know, like, see, this is what we dreamed of the whole time, and there's like two people there, and the studio's falling down.
I was going to say, like, it's got to be tough when, like, multiple people get fired or like, leave a project. So, like, Sacha Baron Cohen obviously...
Greg Williams directed the movie.
His son was the DP.
Sacha Baron Cohen obviously left the project. Bryan Singer was fired. And so, like, I can't say that Rami Malek was, like, affected by morale, because if Sacha Baron Cohen didn't leave, he wouldn't be there.
Right.
So, like, it might honestly be, like, the people that were left on the project were happy about it.
That's what I'm saying. But how would your morale be going in if you're Rami Malek and you know I am not the first choice and I am certainly not the best choice?
I don't think it matters for Rami Malek. Like, this is the
check's clear,
thing
baby.
In this life.
Yeah,
you take it like a superhero. Like, I'm in a Marvel movie. Like, this is gonna be, this is gonna make me famous and a lot of money and maybe an award.
Yeah, I really do think that he was bad in it. I think I might be outnumbered there, but what do we think of how he looked? Because here's my theory. He obviously looked terrible. Didn't look like Freddy. He looked like Freddy in one scene. It was in the early 80s, and he's sitting in the studio after Queen infamously broke up. And he's sitting in the studio, and it was like the Freddy track jacket look. And
He
had like the aviators and the mustache. And I was like, all right, that looks like Freddy right now. But here's my theory. The teeth were obviously very, very distracting, right?
Yes,
very.
It's because
they
his eyes are
bad, right?
It's, well, they were. So here's the issue.
No, I'm saying like
Freddy's
teeth weren't that
Freddy's
bad.
Freddy's teeth were more messed up than those, but
not as
big.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
So I think it's because Rami Malek's eyes are so, like, your face is just drawn to his eyes because he's got these huge Amanda Seinfeld eyes. Right. So I think that they probably gave him correctly sized Freddy teeth, and they were like, we're still seeing the eyes.
Make them bigger.
Ratchet up the
turn up the base of my headphones.
Yeah, right. Yeah. I'm not hearing
the enamel in those teeth.
Yeah, I'm not hearing any teeth here. So then they just made them bigger and bigger and bigger, but they made them, like, clean,
yes,
and
yes,
straight.
Yeah,
like, they just made it a overbite,
like,
but
sort of like pointed towards each other, like in real life.
They just like jutted out in real life.
Yeah, it was just like a giant overbite,
like almost if you spread your fingers a little bit and then just kind of like went like that. But this, they just made it.
I knew
gave him a huge overbite and really, really big teeth. And that's
like
not what Freddy had.
Mouth, basically,
he was.
So I don't know if I told you this before, like, I also, like Jeff, I don't know that much about Queen, and I didn't do that much research about Queen throughout my life. I just like their music.
Yeah.
I think I've said this on the podcast before. I never really knew what Freddie Mercury looked like until I, like, sought out his images. And so, like, this...
Because were you... it might have been you, might have been somebody else. A lot of people were surprised. They were like, why'd they get a Muslim guy to play Freddie Mercury?
I knew that he was, like some Middle Eastern or whatever.
Yeah.
But... Yeah, like, so, like, I can't necessarily, like, weigh in on how Rami Malek looked, because I still, like, don't fully know what Freddie Mercury looks like. He's sort of an enigma to
me. I'm so excited. So, like, we have things to do after this, and there are sports games on, but that's not what we're going to do. I'm going to show you guys so many videos of, let me pick my favorite one, and I'll show you that. Okay. And we'll watch them talking about the stuff they did in the studio. Because when Freddie talks and he says, oh, we quite like doing this, and then we'd put in the, and then Brian would go on tea, and me and Roger would work on the clever little bits, and we quite liked that. And, like, it's just, oh, God, I love him.
So,
I hate this movie.
So I watched Live Aid again today to, like, cleanse the palate.
So good.
And I didn't realize, during it, I thought Rami Malek looked good. But watching it, the real Freddie afterwards, I was like, oh, it's sort of like an exaggeration. He doesn't really look that good. And the first time he cuts his hair short, he looks exactly like Nick Kroll's character from Big Mouth.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
I was trying to find a picture.
That is going
to
be great.
And, like, exactly. And that also then took me out of the movie the whole time.
Yeah, he didn't have, like, the moves and the mannerisms down, which I forgive. Like, I forgive a lot of the
There's only one Freddie Mercury.
Right. Like, I made a joke. Me and one of my coworkers dressed up as two of our other coworkers for Halloween. And the joke we made was, there's this guy, Phil Perry, that works with us, who's this really handsome man. And we were saying, well, we were going to dress like Phil, but if you could look like him, you would just do that all the time. So, like, if Rami Malek could be Freddie Mercury, he would not be doing episodes of 24 and stuff like that. He'd be the biggest rock star.
I love that
on
your
the
reference
planet.
Point of Rami Malek is 24.
It's always 24.
Do you want to know what mine is?
Yes. It's the guy from 24.
Twilight Breaking Dawn Part 2.
No.
Which is an incredible movie. We should watch that sometime. It is. Shout out to Twilight Breaking Dawn
Part
2.
I'm down to skip Bruins and Celtics tonight. yeah. But the cool... So, the Live Aid scene when he's, I think it's during Radio Gaga, when he's like really moving and jumping around with like the half mic stand.
Yeah.
A move, by the way, that Josh Tillman might want to pick up. He could save a lot of money on microphone stands. At first I was like, oh, that's really, really cool the way that he's like moving like him. And it makes me feel like I'm watching it. But then I saw a preview for it the other day and it showed a clip of that. And I realized... What was cool about that was just that they shot it the same way. Like, okay. the camera swung around and did, like, all the stuff. It just captured him the same way. So they made the best of a bad situation, I guess.
From what I can understand, the Live Aid stuff was the first stuff that they shot, and Bryan Singer was definitely a part of that. And, like, it was the biggest set he ever... And I don't know, but I'm dying to know, like, when... Like, where was this new guy? Like, when it all happened? I feel like there is a strange tone shift. Like, all of a sudden, when the reviews for Bohemian Rhapsody start popping up, like, that kind of took me by surprise. Yeah. Like, it was just very strange.
I personally didn't like it. I hated it.
So you mentioned Straight Outta Compton earlier, and I wanted to bring that up, and I wanted to bring up that comparison because I feel like this movie sort of had some of the same afflictions as Straight Outta Compton, and not just talking about AIDS, but like, obviously it was made by members of the group, mm-hmm. and so there's always, when that happens, there's always sort of like a propaganda.
Well, yeah, you're not getting the straight dope,
right? And so I came in expecting that, but. What I will say about Straight Outta Compton, which I did like, I will say that I like Straight Outta Compton, and I think it's very rewatchable, and I cannot say about either of those things about this movie. The one thing that Straight Outta Compton had that this movie did not have, or at least the biggest thing, was that it told me something about NWA's story that I didn't know, and that was the whole Jerry Heller aspect. And
yep.
I think that they did a really good job of telling that part of the story.
Yep.
And like, that is a huge part of NWA's story, obviously.
That's a very, very good point.
And there's nothing to liken that to Bohemian Rhapsody.
Yeah.
They don't do any of that.
Straight Outta Compton told a not completely true story and entertained me. And it meant that I got to watch NWA stuff for 2 hours. I was delighted. I also happily rewatched that movie. Really liked it, knowing that it was not totally perfect. And there were a few parts that you're like, oh, come on.
Yeah, right. I mean, the fact that they completely overlooked, like, the abuse of...
Oh, yeah, but not even that, like, Dre and Easy's beef. Like,
they squashed the beef.
Like, let's squash the beef. You're like, you didn't show beef, sir. We didn't see any beef.
Where's the beef?
Yeah, like, bring out H. John Benjamin to tell me about this, the meats. Love those commercials. But you forgive that, right? Like,
right.
And I think that's what we keep harping on with the Terrible Queen movie, is that... I'd be cool with them flubbing the timeline a little or skipping over certain things. But, like, they're playing these huge concerts, and I'm like, yo, why are people going? You don't have any songs, apparently. All you did was record. People just want to hear Keep Yourself Alive and Doing All Right, apparently, because those are the only songs you guys have recorded.
And the way that they, like, go about, like, how they recorded those songs or how they, like, made those songs... Where not believable.
Yeah,
like,
no.
The We Will Rock You.
So
thing.
Then we all got together and we said, let's write a song. And
get
then
everybody
I said,
get on stage.
Let's write Another One Bites the Dust. And that's how Another One Bites the Dust was written. It was so, like, third grade
and
awful.
In the scene where Rami Malek was like, and we're going to be called Queen. And he, like, falls down on his bed and the notebook. And it's the exact fucking drawing of the Queen logo and, like, the album art. And it's like, what the fuck? Are you also the most talented artist in the world?
Well, he did design
the logo.
Right. Did he really?
Well,
would have been nice if the movie told me that.
Exactly. So, I just assumed it to be a lie.
I don't think they even say, like... He went to school for design. Did they say it in the movie?
They say it briefly.
Okay.
Yeah.
I did. The one
I was
I
like
learn,
locked in the first like 10 minutes. I swear. Like
you didn't know it was a bad movie yet.
Not yet.
The one thing that I did learn, I need to check if this was true, but he says to everybody, he's like, Roger, without me, you'd just be a dentist. And what would you be doing as an astrologist, Brian? And then he gets to John Deacon and he's like, Deaky, for the life of me, I can't think of anything that you could do. Yeah. And John Deacon says, what do you say? Like I studied
electrical engineering or
right.
something like
that. And I was like, if that's true, then cool. Then we got something.
If that's what we're taking
this
away
is the
from
story
this story
of a young man named John Deacon who studied electrical engineering. Bohemian Rhapsody. You want to miss it.
You mentioned Another One Bites the Dust, and that scene was like particularly like unconscionable to me.
Yeah.
Like that they come up with the song, but then it's played, and that's a very like ominous baseline song. And the montage they split it. Remember, it was him going to all the leather clubs and stuff, and it was very like red and black.
Walking
and it, like,
by John Hutton,
it was very much like gay panic. Like very like it made it like it was so like off putting to me and very strange and out of place. I don't know that. Well, it was in place because the movie fucking sucked.
Yeah,
but like it was like it was really poorly done and like handled. It was like I don't know.
Do you know how Another One Bites the Dust was actually written?
No.
John Deacon was at the studio when Chic was recording Good Times, and he popped in, and obviously the bass line for Good Times, I said a hip hop, the hibbit, a hip hip hop, you don't stop, a rock, and he heard them recording Good Times, and like a week later, he was like, yo, Chic has this really cool song, and it made me like think of this. It's kind of a ripoff. I just basically cut the bass line in half, and they made a song of that. And Chic was like, "Yo, what? You were there? That's so cool!" Like it would be like if I were to be like, "Hey, Pete, what are you working on for work?" And you're like, "Oh, I'm writing this thing on this guy, and I'm interviewing him, blah blah." I'd be like, "Cool, let me just make a quick phone call, and then call that guy and be like, hey." Story buddies.
Just thought of a great idea.
So that's how Another One Bites
Did
the
she
Dust.
Get co-writing credit?
I don't know. They
I hope so.
They should have. But this was before. I mean, if it happened now, then Marvin Gaye would have somehow gotten money out of it.
I just keep thinking about that Selena Gomez, David. But now that you're a big Talking Heads fan.
He gets paid for that,
right? He gets paid for that for Bad Liar, because that's just Psycho Killer.
Right, but I think someone
he
one
is
of my
a songwriter
said that like, it actually might even sample Psycho Killer.
Oh, really? Beyond yeah. I don't know. We're getting into bass lines now.
I love Talking Heads, and I'm not. I know I haven't totally broken through. I still have like only 6 songs that I listen to, but man, soon it'll be 7.
Do you listen to Naive Melody?
No,
that's
that?
Probably This Must Be the Place. That's probably like the best song of all time.
Really?
Yeah. It's like that and Since You've Been Gone by Kelly Clarkson are probably the 2 best songs of all time.
Nice. Problematic, Dr. Luke.
Ooh.
Oh,
that wasn't
wow.
cool.
Yeah,
all right, so what are we doing for stamps here?
A no.
That's so good.
I was thinking about doing the poop emoji.
LeConnor for real.
Although
we
you
got
do
the
that.
Poop emoji.
Yeah.
Oh man, Jeff, you go ahead. What do you got for a stamp?
I'm gonna change mine to unforgivable.
Ooh, wow.
Okay.
This movie made me sad.
Oh wow.
I was gonna say that whole thing in there.
I love that. So mine was originally gonna be a long one too. I was gonna stamp it cheesy Queen porn,
mm-hmm.
And I think that's a pretty good description.
But it's not
a
lot of Queen, so porn is. Oh, by the way, I have a porn thought. Go on.
Oh God, Jesus Christ. So I think my stamp, and I think this is the like, it, this movie is useless.
Yes.
It is useless.
Dude, I think, perfect. Go with that. Are you
I'm going to go useless.
Useless, unforgivable, and this movie made me sad. I think we did a good thing here. My point on porn is, so probably for not much longer, I'm a mustachioed man. And a lot of people will say that the big thing is people don't know their decades. They're like, you look like a 90s blah, blah, blah. I'm like, that's not what people look like in the 90s. Stop. But a big thing, everyone says like, ooh, cool porn mustache or cool porn stash, blah, blah. Where did that come from? I've watched porn before. I've never seen like just a bunch of guys with mustaches. Where does that come? And is there an answer? Do you guys have any thoughts?
I would guess if I had one guess, I would guess Ron Jeremy.
Yeah.
Ron Jeremy is like.
So one guy had a mustache? So that. You might, so you should be calling me Freddie Mercury because
like,
that guy,
that dude John about. Holmes, the dude that got like murdered or whatever, like H. I think H. it's like an 80s thing.
H. Holmes.
So here's the thing, if it is a decade thing, because yeah, I think so like maybe it's like a 70s thing.
Everybody,
so then
had
everybody in the 70s yeah. looked okay. like to. In the 70s, you got a mailman stash. Porn? Yeah,
you just make up an occupation. Yeah,
you got an attorney stash.
Cool grocery that's clerk
actually,
stash.
That is actually. You should keep the mustache, and you should just respond to all the hey, nice porn stash. No.
It's this, a doctor stash.
This is a cashier stash.
It's the only thing it couldn't be would be a fireman stash because firefighters can't have facial hair. You know that?
Yep.
No,
because they can't have stuff on their face. Because they got the masks and everything. You got
a lot
get
of
that seal
a lot of
there.
Professions wear masks and they can have facial hair.
You think Bane has facial? Bane has to have facial hair. There's no way he's taking that thing off.
Oh, yeah.
And shaving every day.
He's probably got a strange goatee.
He just has a weird ass goatee.
He probably has like a 70s porn goatee.
Why? He has a weird ass goatee and a weird ass tan line.
Oh yeah. Yeah. I still, by the way, can you? Maybe it's gone. Is there a line? On my head here.
From Texas?
Yeah.
No.
Okay, it finally went away, but for like 3 weeks to a month, I had some sort of like tan line slash sunburn from me wearing a headband in Texas, and I don't regret it for a single second. Yeah, I'm glad that there was, at least you guys are on the same page regarding the porn stash thing, because that doesn't make a drop of sense.
I think we're all in agreement on most everything today.
Yeah, pretty much. Did we want to discuss game night at all?
We'd be remiss if we didn't point out. Oh, also, they're making a Rocket Man movie, and one thing that they're doing, it's an Elton John movie with Taron Egerton.
Taron Killam.
Sorry,
that'd be awesome. Yeah. I just listened to a podcast with him, by the way. That dude was in a fucking SNL, an Oscar-winning movie, and Hamilton.
Like, wait, what Oscar?
He was in 12 Years a Slave.
Oh, really?
And
right.
He was in Hamilton. Can you think about that? Fucking career is incredible.
Yeah. And he's the rare Mad TV. He might be the first. Is he the first?
He's the second. I was listening to this thing. He's the second Mad TV to SNL guy. I don't know who the first. So someone I've never heard of.
So in Rocket Man, Taron Egerton is
Eggsy.
Singing.
Eggsy, yeah.
Yeah.
Eggsy.
Is singing and actually doing the vocals for Elton John. And I wish they did that in this movie. I found it more uncomfortable.
It's so impossible to do that.
Right.
With Queen.
But technology these days, like honestly, I could get you with the right software, I could make you sound like Freddie Mercury.
They did make everybody in Mamma Mia sound great.
Yeah. Like except for what's her face? Meryl Streep sounded like they had to kill her. They had no choice.
But like spoiler, I haven't seen it. But
you haven't seen Mamma Mia 2?
Or 1.
Wow. I watched it again this weekend.
It just goes to show, like, I was thinking a lot about A Star is Born, mm-hmm. like, being a music movie, and juxtaposing this and to that, like, the fact that, like, you hear about Rami Malek, like, Oscar contention, and then you're like, look at what Bradley Cooper did. That dude played guitar, sang, and acted his ass off.
Yeah.
Like, a bar has been set.
A bar is born,
yeah,
sir.
A bar is born.
A bar is born.
Yeah, so like the Rocketman thing is interesting to me because like, what is the relationship between Taron Egerton and Elton John? Because I'm pretty sure
other than that they do all their projects together.
Exactly, this is their third thing together, which is crazy.
Wait, what was the? I know Kingsman 2.
Kingsman 2, and there was another project where they.
Oh, he sang "I'm Still Standing" in Sing.
Oh, right, that's right. Yeah. So like, what's going on there?
I don't know.
Conspiracy theorists.
I'm going to go watch Sing That movie wasn't that bad. That was okay.
It was pretty good.
It was fine. Yeah,
I watched Kingsman.
Kingsman, yeah.
The second
one
stinks.
Not Kingsman 2. Yeah,
one did stink.
The second one with time. I remember I saw the second one and I was like, no, it wasn't bad. And like a few days later, it kind of hit me. I was like, oh, so that movie blew.
So Rocketman looks like it has some sort of like magical element, like across the universe style. Like, that's cool.
Except
like,
hopefully nothing like across the universe, because that's garbage.
Well, I'm hoping that like maybe that's what this Queen movie lacked. Like, if you wanted to shy away from all the real shit about Freddie Mercury, lean into the sort of like mythical nature and do some crazy shit. Like, I'm hoping Rocket Man is cool like that and takes chances.
I'm just hoping they make him gay.